Good morning, community. Good morning, members and friends of Canyon Hills Presbyterian Church. Good morning, visitors to our live stream worship. We are so glad to have you with us this day as we are invited by our Lord Jesus Christ to come and gather around the table. Gather around the table that you have at your own home. Gather around the body and the blood of Jesus Christ as our redemption, as our symbols of forgiveness. As we enter this historical time of unraveling, let us come together and be woven together in faith so that in this time we will not be pulled apart but bound together even more strongly. And that God's kingdom might be proclaimed across the earth. Let us worship together.
Of God send pulls itself together. I'd like to wish everybody a beautiful Sunday, and hopefully we're heading toward a cooling trend because it's been a little bit hot lately. And hopefully those firefighters out there will get a handle on that fire out in the Riverside area. So now please join us as we sing 10,000 Reasons, Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, I'll worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness chorus I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. Yes, I'll worship Your holy name. Yes, I'll worship Your holy name.
Good morning. Please join me in the prayer of preparation. When we come to this space, we bring all of ourselves. We bring joy and hope, dreams and prayers, grief and doubt, memories and heartache. With open hearts and authenticity, let us worship our good and gracious God. God of creation, humanity is capable of such evil. Stories in Scripture alongside stories on the news remind us that truth all the time. For the moments of exclusion over inclusion and fear over hope, forgive us. When we choose pride over what is right and comfort over justice, show us mercy. And when we numb our pain instead of leaning into empathy, unravel us, for we long to be changed. Gratefully we pray. Amen. God meets us here. God hears our prayers, and He sees our scars. In Jesus Christ, we are redeemed and made whole.
Standing by my window on a cold and cloudy day, when I saw this hearse come rolling for to carry my mother away. Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? A better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky.
I told thee, undertaker, please drive slow. Though this body you are hauling, Lord, I hate to see her go.
circle be unbroken, by and by, Lord, by and by. There's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. Hold up and be brave, but I could not hide my sorrow when they laid her in the grave.
Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home sky, Lord, in the sky.
Went back home, Lord, my home was lonesome. Yes, my mother, she was gone. Oh, my brothers and sisters crying, what a home so sad and lone.
Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better sky, Lord, in the sky. Will the circle be unbroken? By and by, Lord, by and by, there's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky.
So instead of Daryl and his other brothers, Daryl, we had a four-lane highway. Ooh. I know it's going to take a minute for that to sink in. So Lane, thank you. Lane is here with us today. So Lane, thank you very much for that offering today. I want to start with a word of prayer. I'm going to do some introduction first before we dive into this scripture passage that we have this day. So let's pray. Almighty and gracious God, we come before you humbled by your majesty, humbled by the breadth of the word that you have for us in all of its complexities. And we pray that we will be able to sit with these stories that you have for us, sit with these narratives, sit with these sacred scriptures long enough to hear your voice through them, even when we may be uncomfortable or unnerved. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. The scripture story that we have for this morning may be one that is difficult to hear. It's a story that maybe you would rather look away. I can't even watch the trailers on TV for scary movies. Like, even if I see the trailer, then I have those images in my head when I try to go to sleep. I also can't watch the Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, the SPCA advertisements with Sarah McLachlan singing in the arms of the angels, playing in the background, those sad and shivering dogs and cats with their lonely eyes. But looking away doesn't mean that the cruelty isn't happening. Looking away doesn't make the problem go away. I think that that is actually one of the key elements in the story of the Good Samaritan that is told by the gospel writer Luke. We cannot just pass by on the other side when someone is in need. We cannot act as if we don't see it. We can't act as if we don't see those living in the shadows, in the margins, in the places where we fear to tread. So in the second book of Samuel in the Old Testament, a theological history of the first kings of Israel, of King Saul and King David, there is an epilogue at the end, the last few chapters, that is chronicling the last days of King David. Chapter 21 tells us a story that is difficult to hear, a story that is rough and gritty, exposing the atrocities that we wish were not staining the reputation of the exalted King David, who is both fiercely faithful and arrogantly sinful. But if our sacred scriptures were to be sanitized from these types of narratives, then the Old and the New Testaments would just be fairy tale stories with happy endings that do not resemble real life. And they would not be helpful or instructive in faith or in living. Without these difficult sacred stories, we would be left with a God who is only present in the good times, a God for those who appear to have it all together on the outside. These raw accounts of enduring faithfulness is why we are assured that our God is with us through the good and the bad and the ugly. These are the stories that declare that our God can even use an egregious tragedy of human sacrifice to redeem a situation through the faithful actions of the lowliest of characters. As a horrific story as this story reads, it is really a story of hope. Let me first set the scene. We have two main characters, Rizpah and King David, and then a cast of background characters who play a role in creating the dilemma that will be faced by King David and ultimately rectified by Rizpah. We are introduced to Rizpah all the way back, actually, in chapter 3 of 2 Samuel as a concubine to King Saul. And King Saul was the predecessor to King David. In chapter 3, verse 7, it says this, and this is from the Message translation. Abner was a commander in the army. Abner took advantage of the continuing war between the house of Saul and the house of David to gain power for himself. Saul had a concubine, Rizpah, daughter of Aiah. One day, Ishbosheth, confronted Abner, "What business do you have sleeping with my father's concubine?" So in one verse, here we have the former commander of now a dead Saul king working to acquire as much influence as possible in a show of power and defiance, and as a symbol of virility, he takes for himself one of Saul's captive wives. This one verse is important for the upcoming story so that we can understand that Rizpah has no power of her own. She has no voice. She has no standing. She is an owned woman in a patriarchal society with no rights of her own. Standing in contrast to Rizpah is revered King David, who as a boy felled the giant Goliath, is a prolific poet and musician, a shrewd strategist and politician, anointed by Samuel to be king, a man after God's own heart, and yet a bold and arrogant sinner. David represents the top of the hierarchy. So here is what happens near the end of his reign, as we learn this from 2 Samuel chapter 21, verses 1 through 14 from the Message translation. Let us together hear this word we have from God. There was a famine in David's time. It went on year after year after year for 3 years. And David went to God seeking the reason. God said, "This is because of the blood on Saul and his house from the time when he massacred the Gibeonites." So the king called the Gibeonites together for consultation. The Gibeonites were not part of Israel. They were what was left of the Amorites and protected by treaty with Israel. But Saul, a fanatic for the honor of Israel and Judah, tried to kill them off. David addressed the Gibeonites, "What can I do for you? How can I compensate you so that you will bless God's legacy of land and people?" The Gibeonites replied, "We don't want any money from Saul and his family, and it's not up to us to put anyone in Israel to death." But David persisted, "What are you saying I should do for you?" Then they told the king, "The man who tried to get rid of us, who schemed to wipe us off the map of Israel, well, let 7 of his sons be handed over to us to be executed, hanged before God at Gilboa of Saul, the holy mountain." David agreed, "I'll hand them over to you." The king spared Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan, that was the one I was going to trip over, the son of Saul, because of the promise that David and Jonathan had spoken before God. But the king selected Armoni and Mephibosheth and 2 sons of Rizpah, daughter of Aiah, who had been born to Saul, plus 5 sons that Saul's daughter Merib had born to Adriel, son of Barzillai, the Mahalalite. There we go. He turned them over to the Gibeonites, who hanged them on the mountain before God. All 7 died together. Harvest was just getting underway, beginning of the barley harvest when they were executed. So you can think around March or April. Rizpah, daughter of Aia, took rough burlap and spread it out for herself on a rock from the beginning of the harvest until the heavy rain started. She kept the birds away from the bodies by day and the wild animals by night. David was told what she had done, this Rizpah, daughter of Aia, and a concubine of Saul. He then went and got the remains of Saul and Jonathan, his son, from the leaders of Jabesh Gilead, who had rescued them, meaning the bones, from the town square of Bethshan, where the Philistines had hung them up after striking them down at Gilboa. He gathered up their remains and brought them together with the dead bodies of the seven who had just been hanged. The bodies were taken back to the land of Benjamin and given a decent burial in the tomb of Kish, Saul's father. They did everything the king ordered to be done. After that, God responded to Israel's prayers for the land. This is the word of the Lord. So when we read this story, we see on the onset, David did first consult with God, but then took matters into his own hands. He didn't ask God how to end the famine. He instead relies on human processes and traditions to expedite the end of the famine, as if human sacrifice would appease God. David follows the societal dictates, the secular rituals meant to expiate blood guilt. And Rizpah's sons become part of the payment by death along with five of their half-brothers. As horrifying as this story might seem, I am glad and grateful that it does not end there. There will not be a happily ever after ending, but there is an example of fearless faith that brings about justice. Rizpah climbs the mountain of God where her sons and five others have just been executed. And she sits in mourning. She sits in grief, with no soft place to land, using an irritating burlap sackcloth as her bed, and fended off the wild animals who wanted to scavenge the dead bodies, and the wild birds that wanted to desecrate them by picking off from the bones. She climbed the mountain of God and she stayed more than 6 months, and it was a gruesome experience, herself having to watch the decay of human flesh become bone. I imagine she had to rely on community to support her faithfulness, relying on others who were also marginalized by society to bring her food and drink, to provide shade from the sun and cover from the rain. She could have walked away and no one would have thought the lesser of her. But she stayed and she relied on God to provide. When I need to remember how it is that God provides, I just remember about Lupe, about Pastor Lupe from our Mexico mission, from our partnership with his church in the colonias of Tijuana. He could have moved out of that area of poverty. He was resourceful enough to get all four of his children, not only through high school, but through college, so that they might provide an even better life. He was able to do those things, but chose to stay in an area of poverty and to work for those who had less. And he used to tell me all the time, God provides. God will always provide. And he shared with me that for 20 years, he had never had to buy a pair of shoes because they were always provided through donations to the church. He did not fear for anything. He had climbed that mountain of God in faithfulness and was serving those who had less. It was Rizpah's steadfast faithfulness, a woman with no standing, no voice, no power, that inspired the king to do what he had been afraid to do himself. King David, after hearing about Rizpah's tireless actions to show honor and provide redemption, does what he should have done decades earlier. For the fallen King Saul, whom he served, and his son Jonathan, who was David's closest friend and soulmate. Finally, David gathers the bones of Saul and Jonathan, those bones themselves being used as symbols of humiliation. He gathers those bones along with the seven other sons of Saul and gives them a proper burial in the tomb of Saul's father, Kish. When I read this story of Rizpah and her sons, I wonder, which mountain of God do I need to climb? Do we need to climb on behalf of those who have no voice, who have no hope, who mourn and grieve and have no joy? In my youth ministry days, I have climbed a lot of mountains, and I have come down as well, and I know the physical pain, the muscle and the joint aches that have seared through my body. I know how hard sometimes to climb the mountain of God, especially when you feel like you have no voice, no power to change things, no story to tell. But that is what this sacred story is trying to tell us. Not only is God with us in the darkest of times, in the most challenging of circumstances, but God is with us when we are faithful and we climb the mountain of God on behalf of others who have no power to change their own circumstances, just like Rizpah. Even when you feel like no one is listening and no one cares. It was Rizpah's actions that ended the famine, not David's. It was David who finally showed honor and redemption because of what Rizpah had done. And then God listened to the prayers of Israel. Many years ago, an optometrist lost his life in the intersection of Imperial and Knoll Ranch Road just after Cannon had been connected and heavy trucks were using that as a bypass route over Cannon and down Imperial on a very steep grade. And a truck that had no business being there with failing brakes barreled through that intersection when children were crossing for school, struck a car and killed an optometrist. And everyone felt like there was nothing they could do. And I thought I couldn't do anything either. But I painted signs and I stood on that corner every single day after walking my kids to school until the city of Anaheim paid attention. And I got meetings with city planners and got meetings with the traffic division. And while we could not ban certain vehicles from coming down that road, they could at least make some modifications and put up signs and make sure that they were enforcing the law by ticketing anyone who was on that road and shouldn't be. We changed an intersection, even though I felt like I had no power. Change can happen when we climb the mountain of God. We are facing great divisions and dissonance right now in our society and in our culture. Maybe you even feel it in your family or among your friends or in your neighborhood. Perhaps this is the mountain we can climb. Learning to understand and appreciate this difficult scripture narrative tells me that I can do the same with those whom I disagree. What if we spent less time posting our opinion and more time listening to the stories and the views of others? Maybe if we sit with those stories long enough, we would begin to understand what is behind the opposing thoughts and ideas and come to understand that in faith we have so much more in common. What if on that mountain of God we could have those kind of conversations? What if on the mountain of God we are able to tend to the needs of those who need our help, our care and our compassion, our time and our resources? You can keep the scavengers of loneliness away. You can keep the wild beast of despair away. You can care. You can write letters. You can make phone calls. You can maybe even share a devotional in those little secret getaways that I know that you're having with your friends, all masked up in the park. What if when you're gathered with your 6 or 7 friends, you step out on that mountain of God and say, "Hey, before we go, can I just pray for all of us?" See, we can climb that mountain of God. See, the story is for those of us who feel like we are unraveling. It's for those of us who no longer need to keep up the facade of having it all together. Rizpah climbed the mountain of God and showed honor and devotion and provided redemption. We can do the same. Amen.
Thank you, Lisa. This is a time when I invite you to share your requests, your prayers, your reflections. I've got 3 folks here that are readily waiting to share that with us, and we will be sharing them here live. And now we turn to the anthem of preparation, In Better Hands.
2, 3, 4.
Time in heaven stands.
video makes me want to play Pass the Baby. That's something I'll name and claim that I missed through this pandemic, being able to have those opportunities to just cuddle those little ones. We are in better hands now, and we are invited to the table of our Lord Jesus Christ, who provides those hands for us, who provides that guidance for us, who provides that inspiration for us to climb the mountain of God. So in this place, we receive the bread and the juice. We receive the nourishment we need for our bodies so that we might go and declare that kingdom of God. We will gather from all kinds of places. You are there at home with your table before you. And we are all invited to share in this time of bringing community together.
Jeremy. Let me start, because we have a rose on our altar. And this represents the announcement of the birth of Jedediah Coy Snyder on Saturday, August 1st, to Misty Coy and Braden Snyder. Joan and Craig are proud great uncle and aunt. And we welcome Jedediah. Boy, we have a lot of old world names being shared today, don't we?
Yep.
We also have a couple prayer requests. The first one is a prayer for Chuck Collins as he is having surgery this Thursday. Lord, hear our prayers. We also have a request from Judy Sepulveda, whose friend Charlie recently suffered a stroke. So we ask for prayers for him. Lord, hear our prayers. And now we turn to the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
With your elements in front of you, I invite you to say these words with me. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, he took the bread, he blessed and he broke it, and after giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples and he said, "This is my body, broken for you. Take and eat." And following supper, the Lord Jesus took the cup and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." You are invited to partake in your communion. I invite those who are present with us leading worship this morning to come socially distanced to the table to take your bread and your cup and to receive your communion. As we are inspired by a cello piece that Connor Bogenreef is featured in.
Thank you.
What an awesome and inspirational piece of music. Please join me in the communion prayer. Oh God, through this bread and this cup, you have made us one with you and with each other. May the unity we find at this table be a gift that we carry out into your suffering, divided world. Help us to find strength in knowing that you, the God of peace, will always be with us. Amen.
It is true that we worship a God of peace. And in this time where peace seems like a scarce and limited resource, we as the body of Christ step out into the world to show peace and give peace and hand peace out. And we do that, and I just wanted to bring up today, we have here this news article, and this was in the Register this last week. And the title is Canyon Hills Presbyterian Has a Mission to Help. And it goes through and outlines how we fulfill Jesus' great call to ministry. You see, Jesus said that when he ascended into heaven, that we should start in Jerusalem and then go to Judea and then to all the world. And see, our live stream this morning, we reach our Jerusalem. We reach all of you that are out there that are connected to our church in one way or another. This is our city, our community, our family of faith. And we reach out to you, and we hope that by proclaiming the message of Jesus Christ to you, that you feel empowered to proclaim it to Judea, to the people that you interact with. And we as a church proclaim it to Judea. This outlines our interaction with Lot 318 and providing food for families that are not food secure because the school lunch programs have been interrupted. It also talks about how we reach out to our partnership in Mexico, not a short-term mission group across the border, but a partnership that we've had for 30 years with deep love and mutual respect and affection, where we bring the peace of Christ to people, not because we want a place to go on spring break, but because we feel called by Jesus to spread the hope of the gospel to all the world outside of our own city, outside of our state, outside of our country. And we fulfill all of those goals. We fulfill all of those aims so that you, the people that are listening to us, might know that Jesus is living and active, that the Word of God is breathing and moving. And when in the Old Testament God says, "Behold, I'm doing a new thing, do you perceive it?" We can say, "Yes, we perceive it because we're a part of it. It lives in us and moves through us." If you'd like to know more about what we're doing and how we're proclaiming Jesus Christ, we ask that you go to canyonhillspc.org. That you click on our missions. If you would want to serve alongside us, click the serve link. If you want to grow deeper in your faith and find profound spiritual formation during this time, click devotions and join us every day at 5 o'clock for a daily devotion. If you want to find an intimately knit group of people to share Jesus Christ with, join a home group. If you'd like to share your blessings with those people that are less fortunate, then click give and share those blessings with the people that are so desperate right now. I don't know if you know this, but as of today, rent protection in California has ceased. And so we find in August now people that have lost their jobs are suddenly also losing their homes. This pandemic is going farther and hitting harder than any of us ever intended. And so we do not slow down or step back. We do not protect ourselves first and others second. But we who rely on Jesus Christ for safety and peace share that safety and peace with others first, because we know who is our ultimate hope and our ultimate salvation. So join us in reaching and proclaiming Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, to this world.
Matt, thank you very much. Thank you for inspiring us yet again to do the work that we have been called to do through Jesus Christ. And sometimes that requires us to climb a little higher, to go a little further, to trust a little bit more. Because when we do, we will not be disappointed. Because Jesus Christ will be with us by our side as we endeavor to do the works of the kingdom of God here, right here on earth. So this week, as you go from your homes maybe out into the world, socially distancing and masked as safely as possible, I want you to think about the places that God is calling you to make a difference, where you thought you had no hope of making change, because you do. So let us reach out and reach up and climb higher as we go with God's blessing and the hearing of our prayers. Amen.